Good evening or good afternoon, guys and girls. It's an honor and pleasure to introduce Daan Roggeveen. Can you pronounce the name? Roggeveen. Very good. Sometimes my wife, when she's mad at me, she thinks that the Dutch talk like expression machines. They can just say really well. Okay, this lecture is actually co-hosted with the Center for Asian Studies, so we're also very grateful that they're willing to kind of chip in and also send a large contingency to this room. Daan is an architect. He graduated from the Technical University of Delft, happens also to be the same university I graduated from. After he worked in Holland for about a year and a half, he decided to explore the world. He ended up in Shanghai and actually has been there for the last 9 years or so. He recently moved back to Amsterdam to start the Amsterdam office. So he now has an office in Amsterdam as well as Shanghai. The firm, the name of the firm is called Moore Architecture. It stands for, what does it stand for? Multidisciplinary
Office for Research and Architecture.
Okay, something like that. He will explain it to you in a second. I had it here and actually spaced out, so I apologize for that. So Daan is an architect and he does a lot of work in China. He's also the author of two books, and he's here as part of a lecture series in the US. So he flew in from New York on Monday. He went to Kentucky 2 days ago, and he's flying to LA tomorrow morning, but he found time to kind of stop by our wonderful little part of the world. The two books he wrote is, one of them is called How the City Moved to Mr. Sun, which deals with China's new megacities, which came out in 2011, and he recently co-authored or co-kind of curated a book, and that's called Prosperity and Progress. And he's going to talk about his architecture, and he's going to talk about his writings and his observations about working in China and all across the world. So give him a warm welcome.
Right. This going off the sound. Thank you, Kevin and Marcel, for the kind introduction. Thanks for inviting me here. I'm very excited to be here. Had a beautiful day yesterday with Marcel taking me around Boulder, and today waking up with snow was a very exciting thing. I didn't see that much snow in a long, long time, particularly not in October. Thanks everybody for turning out, coming in today. And for the studio professors for hosting me today, particularly Seth Wildering, I don't know, he must be here, and his students, thank you. And of course also Sean for helping setting this up. All right. Let me take you to Oxford Road in Accra, Ghana. This is Oxford Street, sorry. Saturday night, early July last year, I ended up in this Casino Gold, around 1 a.m., together with one of my co-workers. And once, I'm not that much of a casino goer, but we were kind of curious to go in. And once we went in, we met this guy, the guy here in the blue shirt. Started talking to him, and he was a contractor from Chengdu in Western China. And he worked in Accra for about 3 years. And he was constructing actually the highway between Accra and Kumasi, the second city in Ghana. And he was actually not the only Chinese person in that room. Turned actually out that there were only Chinese people in that room. apart from the personnel. But that was kind of an interesting encounter. So we were there, you know, hanging around the blackjack and roulette tables, talking Chinese, eating Chinese food, smoking Chinese cigarettes, and listening to Chinese music. And this was a complete Chinese world in the heart of an African capital. Now, what does that mean? What does such a, let's say, globalized environment mean in such a city? That's what I hope to talk about today. Because today I want to talk about books and buildings. That's basically what we do. And So it's a bit of an ambitious talk, and I hope that that it's going to work out. So bear with me. The idea is that we have this new book that Marcel already mentioned, Progress and Prosperity. And the idea of today is that we're going to connect the theory of this book to the practice of our office. Now, that is going to take some mental U-turns here and there, and also your stamina, because I have 250 slides and 40 minutes, so I'm not sure how that's going to work out. But what we're going to do is we have a short, I'm going to talk a little bit about Chinese urbanization, then around 10 minutes I'll flip you through a couple of the highlights of the book, and then I'm going to talk about four projects of our practice. And then we might, if everybody is still hungry, we might have time for dessert, which is a special project that Kevin already mentioned, the one in Accra. Anyway, so this book is actually the result of 5 years of work that started at the University of Hong Kong, where I was leading the public program in Shanghai. I moved to China, as Marcel mentioned, 9 years ago. First working on research, urban research, then started my own practice, more architecture, and I worked as a curator at the university, where I invited architects and planners and so forth to lecture, actually. And that work, those lectures and those contributions are bundled in this, brought together in this, this book. 5 years ago, no, 6 years ago, we launched this book, How the City Moved to Mr. Sun. And this is a collaboration between me and Michiel Hulshoff, a journalist. We met each other in Shanghai at a party. We always said it was actually a very lousy party where we met. It's true, huh? It was very lousy. And so we had nothing to, we had to entertain ourselves in a way. And then we started talking about urbanization, because that's what you do when you are bored. Of course. So, but what we found out then was that actually we were both interested in cities in the hinterland of China. So we were saying like, okay, everybody's focusing on Shanghai, Beijing, Shenzhen now in terms of, let's say, research. But how would actually, we heard a lot of stories about urbanization in the hinterland. Let's go there and let's find out what is going on. What is actually, how these cities develop themselves. And just to give you a kind of mental framework, until 1978, China was a rural society. So that means 80% of the people in China lived in the countryside. Only 20% of the people lived in cities. And that started to change after 1978, when Deng Xiaoping, the leader of China back then, decided to push urbanization and change actually the economic model from a rural to an urban model. So the idea was to focus not so much on agriculture, but to start to industrialize the country and to do that through cities. And that process has, as everybody knows, has led to immense economic growth and growth of cities, but it's still continuing. In the coming years, until 2050, expectation is that around 300 million people will urbanize. That is as much people as there's inhabitants in the US. It means that we have to build an infrastructure in China that is supporting the whole of the US, similar size, roads, railroads, airports, hospitals, universities, schools, residential buildings, offices, and so forth. Imagine that you have to rebuild the whole US between now and 2050. That is basically the challenge that we are facing. By the way, interesting to tell, the size of the US is the same as the size of China, exactly the same. But the number of inhabitants is 4 times higher, of course. We have 4 times more inhabitants in China than we have in the US, so that means the density of 4 times higher. Okay, so we have looked at the level of urbanization in different countries around the world. We see that the US has been, so this is time, this is percentage of urbanization, time from 1950 to 2050, level of urbanization, and we see that the US has been urbanized for around 70% already since the 1950s, right? And that number is a bit stable. It's a bit increasing to 80% or something. And if you look at China, until 78, 20%, and now exploding. So, and that is basically what we investigated in the book through journalistic means. So because my colleague is a journalist, We started to do interviews and street reports. We would talk to planners, architects, government officials, people on the street on what are their experiences in urbanization in China. So we see that the Chinese urban model is a model that combines top-down force with bottom-up initiatives. That is actually the power of the model in China. China is a strong state that allows for cities that emerge seemingly overnight, and it's combined with bottom-up initiatives, bottom-up energy, particularly by farmers that are actually the migrants that provide for the cheap labor who built these cities. These guys that built these skyscrapers are basically farmers. These guys, they step down the field, they pick up their bag, they go to the city and start building skyscrapers. That leads to cities that have a high level of repetition to allow for fast construction and fast investment because it is happening in an environment where, let's say, demand outpaces supply. And that means also that actually developers don't have to be so critical of what they offer, because the market will embrace it anyway, be it either for people to live in it, to live in the housing, or as investment objects. So that means that this is roughly the urban model or the urban residential model that we have in China. Residential compounds, that means towers facing north-south facing towers of 30 floors high, surrounded by a wall or a gate or a strip of shops that are actually gating off the inner public space from the outside. It leads to cities, let's say, with winners and with losers, and basically creating a highly repetitive city with, you can say, with the increasing difference between the groups in society, and with, let's say, also an increasing struggle on how to keep the city healthy, particularly environmental issues. Everybody knows that air pollution, traffic, and so forth are pressing quite a bit on Chinese cities. That was actually the first book. So roughly, that was the idea, the model, the top down versus bottom up, that relationship, investigating how the different elements of the model work, development of business districts, development of residential zones, how China deals with its environment, how China deals with the city as an investment object, and finally how China deals with also the city as a place for different cultural groups. What we discussed this morning, actually. So what is this new book about? It's actually trying to discuss the current status quo of Chinese cities, basically starting with the framing of that we could say, well, China's cities are actually the world's most successful urban scheme. Because it has, over the past 3 decades, pushed 300 million people from rural life to urban life. It has created unprecedented economic growth. It has created jobs for millions of people. Infrastructure works very well. Public transport works very well. There's proper housing for a lot of people. There's a low crime rate. It is attractive for investors. And it has also a glitzy skyline. So can this type of model, can this metropolis be the blueprint for cities globally? That is actually the key question of the book. Now, the question is also, what's the answer? We divided the book in 3 sections. First, we talk about context, that is actually to say the context in which the book is conceived, Shanghai. So we have a couple of 3 essays actually on the background of Shanghai, gentrification in Shanghai, and economic zones in Shanghai. And then we focus on prosperity, and finally the theme of progress. So what is urban progress, and how is urban progress something that can have influence on cities? We have a wide range of contributors, academics, architects, and activists. What are these people talking about, and what has changed in the 5 years since we published our first book? Now, the key thing that has changed is actually after decades of double-digit growth in China, we're now facing a slower economy. Factories have been closed. Factories have been moved abroad from China to Vietnam to Bangladesh and so forth. If you look in the labels of your clothing, you will not only find made in China, but you'll also find made in Pakistan or made in Bangladesh or and so forth. And Chinese cities are focusing more on sustainable growth. That is both more sustainable economic growth, but also sustainable environmental growth. Pollution is a big topic in Chinese politics right now. Leaders try to avoid and try to reduce air pollution. These are active programs that the Chinese government wants to introduce. And another very important part, and I'll get back to that, is the transformation of the Chinese economy into a service industry. China used to be the factory of the world, obviously, and is trying to move into a service-oriented society. That has to do with the fact that the education level of the Chinese is just increasing. And it's finally getting into a hotbed for innovation and IT. One example being Mobike. This is a picture taken in the streets of Shanghai. The Mobike is a shared biking scheme that you can use with an app, and then you can just pick up a bike and bike around. So a bit similar to City Bike in New York, but then this is without, so you can just leave the bike anywhere and you pick it up again with the GPS system. There's three different competitors now. They're all throwing their bikes on the streets of Shanghai, Beijing, and the whole country. And this is also a model. This is a scheme that's also already introduced in Manchester, Amsterdam, Rotterdam, Milan. So this is one example of, let's say, Chinese urbanization or Chinese urban concepts going abroad. I'll get back to that. Now, talking about context, the first part of the book. We have architect Stephen Chen, who speaks about Shanghai, and so this, and he describes the model of economic development zones. So this is a map of Shanghai with a couple of those zones. In it, these are four zones, and he is focusing on this particular zone, Zhangjiang High Tech Park. And he describes how actually these urban areas are created to attract foreign investment. So these are zones that have a separate, let's say they are kind of, have different rules and regulations, different tax holidays, land values lower, and so artificially created lower, so as to attract foreign investors to come to this zone and invest and set up their company there. These zones, this is a concept that China has been using for decades, and that has been the basis for factories across China to set up shop. But now the big change is that it's actually focusing on service instead of production. So the ambition is to become a Chinese Silicon Valley. Interestingly, and Stephen Chen calls this the logic of exception. So within an urban fabric, you create exceptions in terms of regulations, in terms of what the government offers to potential clients, investors, support programs to support companies to come in and so forth. So it's based on the notion of Silicon Valley, but this is top-down planned. You know, this is not. This is not a garage like the way, let's say, Apple started in a garage. That was not the people in Washington deciding that Steve Jobs had to start his firm there. No, that was just an initiative of two guys sitting there, and that became Apple. So that is, of course, the interesting thing here, that the government is proactively pushing this area to be different, to be exceptional, other than the rest of the city, and that has to generate economic development. So again, this idea of the top-down versus the bottom-up. So the top-down allows for certain conditions, and then the bottom-up, then it should be the investors, it should be the entrepreneurs that start their company in one of those zones. The second part of the book focuses on prosperity, so on the relationship between the financial and the urban. So you could say, or in the 1960s, globally, urban planning was a profession to advance the masses, to create. It has become a financial business case. So the city has become a financial business case, attracting corporates and consultants alike. So Adrian Blackwell from the University of Waterloo is talking about financialization of the city in that sense. So he's talking about how the city has become an investment object. So I mean, I was in New York last week, and then a lot of people complained to me that the city is inaccessible for middle and lower incomes. That's a conversation that we have, of course, in the cities around the globe, but also in China. In a communist country, it's actually the city itself has become an investment object. So if you look at this picture, for example, I took it in Inchuan, in Ningxia province, a couple of years ago. This whole tower was sold out, and only these two people were at home. So that means that actually the rest of this residential tower has become an object for speculation, an object for investment. Another element to this is David Gianotten, a partner at OMA Hong Kong. He used to be in Hong Kong, he's now back in Rotterdam, who's talking about in an interview in the book about how the architect should actually move earlier in the process, also in China. And he's suggesting that what they learned, that is something he learned in China. He started to test out in China, and he took that idea now to Holland. We also talked about it yesterday. And the reason, he says, why architects should be focusing on an earlier moment in the process is because the government doesn't have the capacity anymore to do planning. So China was the breeding ground for that idea, and then he took it to Holland, where he just recently proposed with his firm OMA, proposed an urban plan in Rotterdam, developing a new stadium plus surrounding kind of urban development that the city now has approved. So an architect taking the initiative to change urban development. It's a very radical move, because it's basically cutting out the role of the developer, and it is taking over the role of the urban planner, the city planner, sorry. So the architect takes a way more proactive role, a model that he developed in China and took out to the West. Now, then in the third part of the book, we're going to talk about progress. So how cultural development can serve as a catalyst for urban expansion. The meaning, China is currently seeing an explosion in museum construction. And that means actually that museums and cultural buildings are an equal participant in urban China. The size of the museums is growing like immensely. This is a picture of the Long Museum in Shanghai. The museums in China are even getting so big that it can sort of inform a new course in contemporary art. So what we see is that Chinese artists make such big artworks that in some cases they are not able to exhibit their work in European museums anymore, simply because the museums in Europe are from another scale than the ones in China. So this is very radical, because it means that actually architecture informs the potential of contemporary art. But the question is also, are these museums only, let's say, vanity objects, or do they really have the similar content and the similar quality as the museums in other parts of the world? This is something that we also question in the book. But it is clear that this is Shanghai again. This is a waterfront development. This is a 3-4 kilometer waterfront development. Used to be a harbor area and is now a cultural zone, with museums actually being the first drivers of the development. So the city government actively promoted to put museums there. This is a contemporary art museum by the Chinese architect Yo Yitsun. And in the book we also describe this method. So here you see actually what's happening behind. So they put first the museum, and then, so this is the picture I just showed you, and this plot over here is still vacant, and of course the land value increases because the museum is being put there. So actually the government is actively promoting cultural development as a driver for urban regeneration. And so basically the formula is strong leadership, the government, or visionary leaders, plus remarkable architecture, creates a new identity for certain urban districts. That is happening all around the world, but it's also happening, and particularly happening in China right now. All right, and then the third part. So that is talking about reverse, let's say, globalization. So how Chinese urban development is also being pushed outside of China. For example, here in London, where real estate firm Wanda is also investing in and building this skyscraper next to the River Thames. And that, yeah, and selling that, and also being very clear about it. This is an advertisement in the Financial Times, where they even clearly put their logo and their identity. So the it is so where, let's say, the British and the French and the used to enter Shanghai as colonizers. Now the opposite happens, and the Chinese are taking over part of the city center of London and influencing urban life there, of course. So the key, the three, let's say, key conclusions are a movement towards the service industry, so from made in China to designed in China. Right? Let's call it that way. The second part is what I call culturalism, which is an awful word, but I thought it was funny to put it like this, but then actually it's not. And the third part is export. So can China export its global model, and will it export its global model to across the world, and like in this kind of examples. So actually the question mark, we can delete the question mark, it's maybe an exclamation mark. Okay, so here we are with the, let's say, the three key there's more sub conclusions to the book I was talking about with Timothy Oakes this morning about tourism. I think there's also some remarks about tourism in the book that are actually interesting that I wanted to talk about today, but I think the time is a bit limited. Some other elements that we're missing now, gentrification and how Chinese cities are dealing with that. Let's stick to these three things. Design in China, moving to the service industry, role of culture, and looking abroad, pushing abroad. Now, here's the mental U-turn. So we're now going to see how we as a firm, with our office in Shanghai, deal with these three themes and how let's say our clients are actually framing our work and how we can respond to that. So the first one, design in China. So that is a project. What we call Mint, Mint Headquarters, well, we call it that way, but it's also the name of the firm. So that's our client. Mint is a company in the car industry. And in 2009, China took over the US as the biggest car market in the world. So that means that this is a market that is exploding gigantically. And our client is developing plastic molds. So they make window frames and how do you call it? The things to put on your wheel and the grills and so forth for cars. For 80% of the car brands in the world. But with this kind of, so they started in 92 with product manufacturing. They're now also developing products for clients, so for BMW and Volkswagen and so forth. And they're even moving into electrical car design and production. So they are one of the 15 companies in China that have a license to make electric cars. So that is actually pretty radical. If you think about it, that they can make electric cars for a client base of in potential 1 billion people. We're looking at quite a company in I wouldn't say chaos, but at least in a dynamic environment. So we received in 2014 the question to design the interior of their new headquarters. So and then they gave us the their number of people in the key departments. But for them, it was very hard to predict how their departments would develop, you know, because we asked them, like, yeah, is this real? You know, is this really what your departments are going to look like? They said, well, yeah, 2014, we know. 2015, probably yes. 2018, yeah, well, it could be anything, you know. So simply because, and then we started looking at their former headquarters, and it looked like this. So this is like a conference room where actually people were put together, like, behind desks, and these four guys are with three people behind one desk and so forth. So it was like really like a very dynamic environment where people had to be very flexible to basically survive. No. So this is the new, this is not our design. So just to, I want to be very clear. That this, so we do the interior. We didn't do the building, we do the interior. Yeah. So this, but we had to do the interior for this guy. So that is roughly 200,000 feet, 800 people that we had to house there. And To give you a bit of a context, so if you look at Google Earth, this is this is their factory. This is the factory where the company sits. This is the headquarters, the old headquarters, and this is the yellow thing, the location of the building that you just saw. Now, this is in 2014. This is 2006. So how can you design an environment that changes so quickly? That is actually the key question here. And where we also know that they are so that their challenges and their, let's say, potential growth is massive. So unpredictability became actually the key driver of what we had to do or what we had to deal with. And then we said, okay, then we have to develop a system that actually allows for change. So we designed a system that we called the barcode, where we said, okay, if we have zones in a building if we divide the building by zones and we make a difference between the fixed program and the flexible program, fixed program being archive, storage, IT, that kind of stuff, pantries, and we have the flexible program, meaning people, and we alternate those, then we can create a kind of barcode system where between the bars you can actually change everything. And then it doesn't matter actually what happens between, you know. So this is the layout for one floor. This is the third floor. And basically the bars are oriented in the north-south orientation, allowing for the sunlight to go deep into the building. And at the same time, between the bars, anything can happen. It can be a meeting room, it can be a working space, it can be an informal meeting area, and so forth. And it can densify over time also. Also, it allows for views between different departments. So what is actually happening is that we created a mixture between the cell office and the landscape office. So it's not only flexible and it's not only fixed, but it's kind of in between. So this is then the sort of environment we created. And so mind you, we came from this kind of, this was their previous office, where also there was a huge difference between, let's say, staff and management. So staff is left and management is right. And we try to also democratize that a little bit, and create this kind of environment with the bars in glass and the stainless steel. A very clean ceiling that solves basically all the insulation problems, so you don't see any insulations anymore, and a very clean structure, because people will in the end also create the diversity in this office. So what you just saw on the plan, so you get this kind of landscaped depth of these different bars, so creating a kind of perspectives, meeting rooms, informal meeting areas, where we could also design the furniture and so forth ourselves, so we could really control the full building, the bars made in aluminum. And then, as opposed to the bars, we also created specials to create identity actually in the floors. For example, this staircase in the lobby that can be also used as a kind of auditorium. We created what we call the green lobby, what the client now calls the oxygen bar, which I think is kind of funny. That, but my sense of humor is different than yours. I have the feeling. Basically with the idea to not have everybody have one plant on their desk, but then concentrate all the plants and put them all in one room. And I thought it was even a good idea to make this a Wi-Fi free room. So this is, let's say, the area where you don't have any connection. So you cannot receive, so kind of initially we were thinking maybe you can make a Faraday cage here. So once you enter this room, you're just disconnected. But no, the client didn't want that. But no, yeah, it can be, I mean, I think that's the future actually. So that is, so plants inside the office. We proposed a circular lecture room. We thought it was very good to have the boss standing in the middle of his people instead of in front of it. So it's not, let's say, a kind of military briefing, but it's an environment where the boss is surrounded by his people, and also people can see each other, almost like in the Greek and Roman theaters. And surprisingly, after the first presentation, they accepted that idea. So we were able to pull that off, and they're using this room like every day. A client asked for war rooms. So these are rooms where the they have to when they have meetings with the different clients. For example, they want to talk to Volkswagen here and they want to brainstorm with BMW there. Then it has to be, that has a high level of confidentiality, of course. And they somehow the client came up with the word war room. So we were like, war room, what does that mean? So I started to think about James Bond and this kind of stuff. And then in the end, we came up with a room with all kinds of protruding kind of cabinets and so forth. And these are surrounded by polycarbonate skin, so that we create this kind of sci-fi environment. And on the inside, everything is rotatable, so including like rotatable screens. From the back, you can not see them. Here we have like bookcases that are hidden. So once a competitor comes in, you can just turn everything, and it will be totally secret. And then we were able to basically control the whole building, which is rather unique in as an architect in general. To have a full control, but in China it's particularly it's kind of unique. Now, in terms of materiality, we wanted to actually relate to the fact that this is an industrial company. So the fact that this is a factory, they are making cars, right? So aluminum, steel, glass were the materials that we work with. In the first floor, we used terrazzo to make it a kind of special feel. So the conference center in the first floor has a terrazzo, green terrazzo floor. And then every ceiling has a different type of lighting. So the first floor is circular, and the second floor is straight, and the third floor is diagonal, and the fourth floor it's a cross. So because when you're standing on the outside of a building, you only see the ceiling. Yeah? That is what Mies van der Rohe taught us. Industrial materials. The VIP rooms in wood, so that the VIPs have a kind of can escape from this industrial environment. And then, this is the ceiling again, so you see the different types of lighting and everything is hidden above it. Informal meeting spaces. So everything in the end ties back to a like super systematic approach that recently we did an exhibition in Beijing Design Week, and we try to explain everything, the grid that we propose, because it's like a superimposed grid of structure, HVAC, MEP, sprinkler, and so forth. So this model, we try to explain that actually. All right. So how does culture actually influence urbanism? And we have encountered that in a couple of projects now. Some very exciting ones, and I'm going to show you one competition that we recently did with Soil, architecture firm from New York. So we collaborated on a museum for Zhengzhifa in Shanghai. This was a government project in the sense that it was a clear commission from the government to push cultural development, and Zhengzhifa is a Shanghainese artist. Used to be an oil painter. He passed away in 2007, and he made beautiful oil paintings, combining very often broad strokes with the dark color, and that he would fill in later with the smaller color, also here. So he would put it down a couple of strong strokes with in dark, and then he would fill it in with a more thin piece, colorful ink. Very nice artwork actually. So we try to use that same concept to develop our building. Basically saying we have a couple of cores that are the key drivers or the key strokes actually to organize our building, and then around that we start building up the volume. And at the heart of the building we have a courtyard that is actually let's say the nature that Zhengzhifa was also inspired in his artwork. So left we have a kind of artistic diagram, in the sense that we try to kind of resemble his artwork. This is not a painting by him, and this is the top of our model. So you see the cores here, and then the building is kind of organized around that, with the courtyard at the heart of it. So very beautiful location across in the downtown Shanghai, across a park, surrounded by skyscrapers. Actually, the government sort of kept one spot free for this museum. So you see also the strong hand of the government to basically appoint a certain part of the city and say, okay, this has to be, we have to celebrate our local artists. We have to, so they kept that spot particularly for that museum. And then we organized in the first floor in red all the public program. At the back, so in the, let's say in the north is the public program, in the south we have storage, and then the third and the fourth floor we have the exhibition spaces. So you see on the left there's the explanation in Chinese, so we're really from China. The humor doesn't connect, it's like it's not going well. I have to work on it. Okay, so this is the model, and then this is this section. So trying to basically take people from the first and second floor, this is the library, up to the third and fourth floor where the exhibition happens. So the exhibition is actually happening around the courtyard, and then people are going up through these cores here. Now these cores are sort of real organizers of the space, as you can see in this sectional model. So I cannot point here, but you see the double curved exhibition spaces. This was a theme that Sohil was already working on, and that we incorporated in this building. So we worked on it together to develop that concept further of the double curved concrete roof, because it's of course creating a very beautiful roofscape, but it also allows the light to come in and being filtered in a very elegant way. You see that actually we broke down. I also talked to students today about breaking down the scale. In this case, we also talked about how can you make one volume and at the same time break it down into several volumes, push down certain elements or certain facades as to create entrances or a beautiful moment where you have more shade and so forth. So a few from the top, the core. One of the cores that has a very dramatic staircase of moving people two or three floors up. Actually, light coming from above, so this is a very dramatic space actually. And then you arrive in the exhibition space with the double curved roof that filters the light in a kind of indirect way. Round floor with the entrance on the north. You can see, and then you go around this reception, and then you arrive in a kind of double high space. That's the heart of the building. On top of the double high space, we have the courtyard, public programs around it, the auditorium here, three educational rooms that are related to the garden. And the double high space also has like a roof light, and you can see the library there. And from the library, you can look down again. And this double high space can be used for multiple functions, including events and exhibitions and also performances. So it's an overview of the building with the courtyard in the middle, the courtyard space, 1 to 50 model of the, I don't want the 30 even, of the double curved roof. So we had a Swiss intern who was completely crazy about plaster, who made this whole model in plaster actually, spent 2 weeks of his life on plastering, and Jean Loup, very talented guy. But he struggled. We were actually by making the model actually also exploring like how does it actually work, the double curved concrete, and so by that was the beauty of making that model actually, and we work a lot with models to explore like hey how does this technically work. We worked also with engineers. German engineers, SBP, a firm that's based in New York, also in Beijing, or in Shanghai, sorry, to work on that a double curve. And the double curve has, of course, a beauty that it has a curve on one hand and a convex. Do you call it convex? Yeah. So one section will have a curved section. If you cut through the building in the other direction, it has a convex. So that creates, of course, a very rich experience when going through it. And a rich, very rich roofscape that also refers again to the work of Chang Shifan. And then we came in second. So that didn't happen. Yeah, that was a very sad moment, particularly because the site is not only very beautifully located next to the park, but also midway between my house and the airport. So I'll pass by this site every 2 weeks or something. And then I'm like, oh, this could have been so nice. But anyway, that's part of, I once heard the on average an architect has 1 to 7 or something in competitions, like projects that happen. Yeah, no, so I don't know. 7 more to go and then we get one. No, but this one did happen. So I'll speed up a little bit. I hope everybody is still with me. It's dark and warm. And yeah, okay, good. So, okay, this is a project we did in Jiaxing in China. This is an hour drive from Shanghai, city of around 1 million people. And we were asked to work on the site that you see here in the yellow rectangle. Now, this is the aerial picture of the site in 2003. This is 2006. This is 2006 as well. 2010, 2012. This is actually when I first came to the site. So our client was asked us to look at this site. This is, just for your explanation, this is a residential compound that they're building, villas and high rises. And these are factories. Blue roofs are all factories, residential factories, empty land. But this will be residential in a few seconds. Residential, residential, farmland, and this is now office. And this is a research center that has now one tower and has a second tower in a minute. So, okay, so watch it. This is 2012, 2013, 2014, we started construction, 2014. And 2015. So basically going in 10 years from this to this. So just as these are all small farms. This is all water. And these farms are all built along the water. So this is a wetland. It's we're in the river delta, the Yangtze River Delta, so close to the sea. So it's a very wet environment. And so this is what urbanization looks like. Now, how to deal with this kind of unpredictability and this kind of massive change, and change not only on an urban scale but also on a scale of people's lives and so forth. This resembles on all kinds of levels, of course. Now, normally, this is the way the city takes over the countryside in China. This is a picture I took in Mongolia in 2009 or something. But it is, I don't have to explain anything. This is very clear what it is. 100 meter high towers, and then next door there's still farming going on. And this is very, very usual in China. So we were talking this morning with Timothy also about, let's say, the relationship between the city and the countryside. But that what I learned in China is that the countryside is never far away. Be it in people, be it physically. We can live in an apartment tower, but next door there can still be farming. We're now doing a downtown Shanghai project, where literally I was looking at the office renovation, and I looked. This is like the heart of Shanghai, and I was looking down, and someone was farming, like literally. But this is like Central Park, and next to Central Park, if you would be in a tower next to Central Park in New York, and someone's farming on the ground. So that's still, people know how to farm. I would not even know how to do that, you know. So it's also, the city is also very close in terms of, let's say, personal life. Everybody, like, if you imagine that half of the people that live in the city come from the countryside directly, that means that their parents are still farmers, or their grandparents. I mean, I've never, let's say, even slaughtered a chicken, let alone a pig or something. My grandfather knew how to do it. My mom has watched it. I mean, if you leave me 3 days without food, I die. That's just simply the case. So, that, but it's, I mean, it's a stupid joke, but it's also saying, like, that is urban life also. So that means that I'm really urban. I can really not deal with a rural environment. That's not good or bad, it's just a fact. And whereas many people in China have, let's say, the countryside still very much in their DNA. Anyway, so this is basically the normal way the city takes over the countryside is a confrontation. So it's a strong confrontation. And so we try to deal with that in another kind of way. Basically saying, can we break down the volume and the scale of the building in a kind of elegant way so that it's trying to deal with scale on a more intricate level. And our brief was a mixed-use building. So you're pointing out already the one that it's... Okay. So this is the one we picked. Randomly? No, not really randomly. Because the key of the building is actually that we took a building that is not only a building but a complex of volumes surrounding a central square. So it was really important for us to create a building that allowed for small-scale urban public space. We talked about in Seth's studio today about urban space and how to deal with it. Intimate urban space that is allowing for street profiles that are nice, that provide shade, but also a place that is car-free and opposed to many public spaces in China, maybe the public squares in China, is also a square that's not meant to, let's say, express power, but express collectivity. And I think that is a theme that is in our office that I find very important in everything that we do, that in everything we do, we try to find a space or room for collectiveness as a theme. So this was. I don't say so much about the design process. It's just, well, it seems that randomly the building is there, but it's there. Has been a process. Okay, so hotel, short stay apartments, gallery, restaurants, kindergarten, swimming pool, and four offices on the corner. So we positioned the offices at the corners overlooking Central Square, and the public programs, or let's say sort of public programs, at the square, so to generate activity. It's a very simple scheme. The offices are looking outwards, and then public space is looking inwards, creating life. So this is the building. We were able to even include, like, so we did quite almost everything, landscaping, roof landscaping. The four different offices have four different roof landscapes, and then architecture, and we could also do interior design. We worked with the Spanish sandstone panels to cover the facades, so to filter the light, then we move in. Oh, now you see the second tower, right? So when we started building the first, so we were actually slower than the tower. So when we started construction, they were like here. And then before we finished, they were here. So this is also to kind of give you a feeling. We're slow architects in China. we're a slow firm. That's true. Okay, now the street profile is of 6 meters wide. So to create a kind of intimate scale and almost the materiality that goes around. So this is the sandstone and it's granite in the street, but the color is attempting to be the same. Atrium of the Sunken Plaza, that's also a kind of auditorium. The ginkgo trees here, they are like green, but they will turn yellow in mid-November, that is. So here you see the scheme. It is actually, it's rather simple. It is eight buildings and then the square at the heart of it. And not coincidentally, eight is a lucky number in China. So, that is also on purpose, obviously. On the second floor, we created a bridge that connects all the buildings and actually creates a kind of urban experience, because you can walk from your hotel room through an office to the swimming pool and then to the gallery. So it's like you put on your bathrobe and then you go to the pool and then you can see people in the office and so forth. So it was kind of the idea that you really have an urban experience on all kinds of levels. The contemporary art gallery that we created, short stay apartments. This is the hotel. And so the building has a very closed parts and have a very more opening parts. And that contrast is also something we played with. Here you see the section. So the section through, on the one hand, the gallery, that is actually a staircase that goes from the basement to the top. And on the other hand, we have here the conference center with restaurant and then the bridge looking down into the restaurant. the urban plan for Urban Plaza auto section, and then the square. That is rather intimate. So this is our photographer used the super wide angle lens, but it's actually a very intimate square, 35 meters or something. Something like that. The louvers. Louvers are very diverse in their design, so they were very difficult actually to to control in both the construction drawing sets. We had one project architect who had really sleepless nights over this thing, particularly because he didn't speak Chinese, so he had to work with the translator to talk to the facade company. And so this guy was like a super good architect, but I mean, he was Spanish, so he could not make. We had the Spanish guy here, the facade contractor here, and then the translator in the middle, who also turned completely crazy because they had to control all these details. But they did. The three of them did a fantastic job. We could really do everything, including like the lampposts. We were able to design. Our client was really willing to go all the way, including the office interior, which is actually their own headquarters. So it's the real estate firm that is the client also has their headquarters in the building. The office is organized around the courtyard with bamboo. And the cool thing about China is, of course, that you can make whatever you come up with, and particularly with this client, they're willing to also build everything. So it goes from, let's say, small pieces of furniture to 60,000 square feet of in situ pink terrazzo that we could make completely the conference center that is under the building completely with terrazzo. Now, how does this relate to culture? Of course, we have the gallery, the contemporary art gallery in it. So this is a building that is actually a kind of a mini Guggenheim in the sense that it uses the same typology, but then with the difference that we walk up, and then the Guggenheim was intended to go down, of course. The idea was, of course, in the Guggenheim that you would, Frank Lloyd Wright had the idea that you would take the elevator and then you would walk all the spiral down, and in our case, you walk up. In this the staircase, has height differences, so sometimes it's 180 high, the handrail, sometimes it's 110, and that creates a kind of very dynamic environment, arriving at the auditorium at the top. And then the question is, how is that in terms of content? What is what kind of gallery is that? Now, we even helped the client in working on, let's say, a contemporary, an artist to help to set up the opening show. So we went all the way from, and this guy is very tall, so that's the reason of this, Haukawa. he's 2 meters, he's taller than me. So basically, going from this, this kind of environment to this, from contemporary art show back to the countryside, it's only a difference of 12 years. And that, of course, has to do with this level of urbanization. That is actually how you see explicitly how quickly a country is changing, that you can go from, let's say, totally rural environment to a total urban environment in only, 12 years, 10 years. All right. How is everybody? Is it still? Are we still? Because I have one more small thingy to talk about. I don't know if I have time. Yeah? Is everybody still ready for dessert? Okay. You started to get my sense of humor, so I think we're kind of approaching each other midway. That's very good, because, I mean, it was a bit painful in the beginning. But this is good. Okay, so now is now China also exporting their urban model abroad? That is the final question, of course. Now, me and Michiel, the journalist, have been looking at the influence of China in Africa for a couple of years now. This is a picture we took in 2013 in Nairobi. This is the Tika Highway connecting Nairobi with Tika, the inland cities of Kenya. 43 kilometers of highway, 6-lane highway that's completely constructed by Chinese construction firms, without potholes, with working traffic lights, and with signage, everything, even bridges, so that pedestrians can go over it. Now, this is a rare feat in Nairobi or Africa, for that matter. A light rail system in Lagos that we visited in 2014. This light, so this bus system is very famous, of course. This is the key traffic system of Lagos. A Chinese firm has engineered and constructed the blue line. This is a light rail line that is the beginning of a light rail system that will connect the whole city of Lagos. Lagos, a city that is not particularly known for being safe or well organized. That is, and so the Lagos state and the Chinese government have collaborated on this project, the Lekki Free Zone in Lagos, a new city for a potential 500,000 people to live and work outside Lagos in a city that is gated off. You have to use your card to get in, actually. It has private security, it has private electricity and power. No luxury in an environment as Lagos, where you have five power outages a day. Mind you, a day. Separate sewage system, separate waste collection system. So completely disconnected and urban environment that is designed in China. It is designed in Shanghai Tongji University. Also the winners of that museum competition, by the way. So we meet these guys every now and then. But it can even get to a bigger scale, like here in Angola. Where in Kilamba Kiyashi, a new sort of urban environment is created, 750 towers of high rise that are basically engineered and built and financed also by Chinese firms. And this is of course massive. I mean, if you look at this scale, you look it up on Google Earth, and then you will see that this is very much top-down, organized plan that doesn't really connect with the local environment or local building methods whatsoever. Now, we were, based on this research, we were, of course, we are a bit of specialists in urban development in Africa, and we were invited or we participated in a project called Urban Design Labs, organized by UN Habitat, the planning department of the United Nations. And together with Fabric and Lakers and Mix and Okra, for other firms, we worked on a urban plan for the city extension of Accra in Ghana. So that's how I ended up in that casino. Now, why is that relevant? Why is that important? Because actually, remember that there's 300 million people going to the countryside in the coming 35 years in China. Actually, Africa is urbanizing faster. So that means that in the coming 35 years, same period of time, 880 million urban residents will enter African cities. That's almost three times that number. So this is what we have to work on. Well, not only we urban planners and architects in China, in Africa as well, of course, but this is one of the biggest challenges that we're facing in the world, right? That's a huge challenge. Just for your information, that figure, half of that organization is actually based on natural growth. So it is basically, like, families are big in Africa. People get a lot of kids. The other half is people pick up their bag and they go to the city. But it's not only a movement of, it's just also babies being born and they are urban residents. So that is important to note. But so Ghana, we were asked to look at a plan in Ghana. Now, Ghana is a relatively small country, 27 million people. At the Atlantic coast, it is it's the first independent country in Africa, actually. They're also very proud of that fact. And it's a very safe country to operate, a very nice environment. I mentioned the fact that it's safe because it makes it possible, easily possible to operate there. And it is urbanizing very quickly. It has Accra has very low density. This is a picture I took from the plane. Low density, but it has a lot of sprawl, as you can see. This is basically Los Angeles on steroids. And that doesn't help if you want to grow your city quickly for and make it accessible for lower income. Basically, that's the challenge, of course. Now, then the city is also facing a couple of very serious issues, including rising sea levels, flooding. There's a yearly flooding that causes like 30 to 40 people who will simply drown actually in their own city. Very unsafe living conditions in particularly in slums, obviously. And the big question, what are all these new urban residents going to do? What is the economy behind those cities? Because if you have almost 1 billion extra people living in cities in an environment that is hardly industrialized, I mean, there's hardly any factories in Africa. Think about it. There's nothing made in have you ever seen a t-shirt made in Ghana? No. So what are all these people going to do? Now, that is a very, very big question. That is, of course, also related to urbanization and planning and how you organize your cities. And then, of course, there's also traffic, congestion, the clear, let's say, more natural or more simple things. Now, so we worked with a team of five studios together with local planners and architects on this issue. And the beauty of it was actually that we had different disciplines. So Eric here from Fabric is very good at energy and surplus economy and the energy transition program mixed two forms on landscape design, and Abelette was very good at strategic urban planning and also processes. Eric on the left is also very good in process thinking, because this is not only design, of course, it also has to do with let's say, how do you shape, what's the political context behind it? How do you finance it? So it's not just designing a city and that's it now. What is the financial thing about behind it? How does it actually work with land ownership? I mean, this is not just the government having this piece of land. No, this is because of the colonial past of Ghana or the whole of Africa, actually. And the fact that they have tribes, what they call stools over there. The stools actually own the land. And there's also all kinds of historical land claims that are very complicated. And land ownership is not documented. So you have, let's say, you are planning a city of 1 million people, and you don't know exactly what the land ownership lines are. So that is, that's pretty critical when you start designing, obviously. So we started to design throughout all the scales. From the biggest scale, how it relates to Accra and so forth, to the small spot scale from 6 to 80 by 18 meters, which is in total 108 square meters. This was a radical decision that we made. Why? Because the small spot scale in Ghana used to be 450 square meters, which is 4,500 square feet. But that is, of course, quite big. You can put a villa on that, and you still have a garden, and you can put your car in. So we started asking, what is the reason for that? And people said, yeah, we like living on the ground floor, and we don't like high buildings, and everybody wants a piece of land next to their house. Yeah, that is true, but if you want to facilitate like an urbanization process in which only this new town has to accommodate like 1 million people, and these 1 million people don't make a lot of money, then you have to make the city more accessible. So we decided to make the plot 25% of the size of the minimum plot size, which is 100 square meters, 1,000 square feet. Then we started looking at first at water. So what are the risky areas for flooding? And based on the flooding, you made a map, creating a green structure that's actually the buffer zone in case there's floodings and high water levels. And this green structure we could also program, of course. We could integrate sports and food production and so forth and fish farms in these water zones so that these actually become functional areas of the city. Now, then we superimpose the structure of grids on top of the plan we had, a grid system based on measurements of 60 meters. 60 was actually our kind of general grid, And why a grid? Because grids can facilitate all kinds of change, as you know. So, I mean, I don't have to explain that the New York grid over the years has changed dramatically. And that's simply because it's, you know, the grid allows for change. So we also use the grid system. And it's actually, a grid is also in some African cities already being used. This is a picture of a very beautiful one of Ouagadougou, the capital of Burkina Faso. They integrated this, and you see actually that, so it's a very rigid system that allows for infrastructure, but then within the system, within the plots, there are different kinds of infill. So this is almost like the city of the captive globe, but then in African version. All right. Now we started to look at different sizes of the street profiles, of course. So the 60 meter wide streets are used for also containing water buffers, and then we move down to 18 and 12 meter wide streets, looking at the block, like I said, the smaller blocks, how to fill those in, and how to work it down to one, so to one unit of. The minimal plot size, and that minimal plot size would also allow for compound housing, the traditional way of living in Ghana, actually. Now, we could we started to use different land use maps. So this is not a designer, this is a map, or like a scheme. Oh, so I really have to stop now? Or? This is an alarm. And basically trying to integrate, let's say, work and living and leisure all in the plan, and then the plan can develop over time. You can, of course, not like in China, just put in everything at once and say, well, this is it, and just start living there. No, the city has a certain level of incremental growth, so we wanted to the key infrastructure to put it top down and create financing from the top, and then just start selling plots, and these plots can be filled in by people, and then can create this kind of urban environment with, of course, a clear relationship still to the rural or to the water buffers actually that are here that are also used for food production. So food production is also very close by, which is important because we have a city of 1 million people that we need to feed. Okay, so this plan will develop over time, as you will understand. So it's an urban grid, and first it will probably develop around the first axis, the key highways, and then step by step. It will probably fill in. And then these urban clusters, every cluster is around 80 to 100,000 inhabitants, so people can still relate to that kind of scale. So it's not, that's a type of urban level where you still know who your mayor is and maybe know some people we decided to make this kind of middle scale, so for people to be able to relate to their new urban environment. And then this is the kind of end vision that we developed. And we developed this vision with engaging a lot with local stakeholders, local planners, local district mayors, and so forth. And also presented it to the landowners who are sitting in the front here, actually. These are all the leaders of the stools, the guys of the stool towns. This is the leaders of one town, this is the leaders of the other town. And fantastic news, because we just received the news that they actually did a groundbreaking ceremony last month, and this is of course great, because it means that this plan is moving forward. So we will both most likely stay involved here and go back to Ghana early next year to develop the plan further, to deepen it, to work with local architects to push it forward, to start building a new city, hopefully. All right, now let's take one step back, and then I make a final conclusions. All right. So a lot of stuff that we discussed today. The key conclusion of the book, or the key message that I want to put forward today, is actually China has, we have three things that we talked about. China moving to a service-oriented society, made in China, designed in China. That's also what our client Mint is doing. They were making car parts, they're now producing electric vehicles, and the architecture is actually a carrier for that. It's like a it helps them with developing their brand identity and so forth. The second part, culture, is a critical part of urban development. So cultural buildings and cultural life is essential in pushing the development of the city forward. So after building skyscrapers for 30 years, China is now building museums, actually. And the third part, that model is also being pushed abroad, be it, let's say, in London in the form of an investment in a high-end residential building, or be it in terms of these bikes that you saw, the Mobike, or maybe even certain apps that are developed in China and that people here also start to use. So China is actually an urban laboratory to test out ideas. That also has to do with the scale of it and the resilience of the people and the amount of money that is in the system over there. And after testing out these ideas, you can mature them for the rest of the world. Both physical in terms of building, but also non-physical like culture or this bike that I was speaking about. And finally, I think the powerful outbound push of China will continue, particularly because of the fragmented political situation in Europe at this moment and the inward-looking prospects here. So that will only feed into the agenda of China actually being more influential in the world. Thank you so much.